Hello world, it's Siraj, and quantum computers. How do they work and how do they benefit AI? Let's talk a little bit about the theory and then we'll build a very simple quantum algorithm. By the way, the machine that you're using to watch this video, whether it's a laptop or a phone, is an example of a classical computer. It's a general purpose machine. We can code up an algorithm, give it some quality data, and theoretically, it can accomplish pretty much any task we'd like. Streaming live video, creating immersive three-dimensional environments, eliminating existential dread. Actually, it doesn't do that yet. But at their core, all classical computers do something really basic under the hood. Behind every software application is a series of simple math operations. Any task we want to perform on a computer, like booking a flight or playing a game, is translated into a string of ones and zeros, which act as input that is processed by an algorithm, which then outputs a new string of ones and zeros. Algorithms, in all their complexity, in the end, just manipulate strings of bits, where each bit is either a one or a zero. We use ones and zeros because they're a way of representing information such that it can only be in one of two different states. Computers run on electricity, duh. When a computer wants to send information from one place to another, it sends pulses of electricity over a wire. Computers use transistors that can either be closed so that a current flows, or open, which means there isn't a current. Both states are represented using either a one or zero. They're like light switches, either on or off. So when these ones and zeros are stringed together, they can represent any number or letter using binary code. Computers use circuits called logic gates that are composed of transistors connected together, and they compare patterns of bits to turn them into new patterns of bits using simple arithmetic. Hard drives store ones and zeros by changing the magnetic poles of small parts of a metal disk. Positive and negative charges are represented by ones and zeros, respectively. So computers do these two things really well. They store numbers in memory and can process these numbers with simple math operations. I'm just like you. Vote for Siraj and let's make binary great again. In 1965, the founder of Intel, Gordon Moore, predicted that the number of transistors per square inch on integrated circuits would continue to double every 18 months. So far, it's proven to be true. But there is a coming plateau in transistor density. We can only make them so small before the laws of physics stop us. The idea of quantum computing is a potential solution, and that's why interest in it has increased in recent years. The word quantum in physics means the minimum amount of any physical entity involved in an interaction. So a photon is a single quantum of light, for example. That's its real scientific definition. But it's also used colloquially sometimes to mean the opposite, like quantum leap. Or by anything Deepak Chopra says.
The aficionados in the world of quantum physics have somehow hijacked the word for their own use.
Quantum physics deals with the world of atoms and the subatomic particles inside of them. It's really badass because on the atomic scale, the laws of classical physics no longer apply. Richard Feynman put it best when he said, "Things on a very small scale behave like nothing you have any direct experience about, or like anything that you have ever seen. Tiny particles like electrons and photons can take on several states at the same time that at a larger scale would be mutually exclusive. They can be in several places at once or exhibit two kinds of polarization at the same time. We're not able to see this superposition of different states because it disappears once someone tries to measure it. Nobody really knows how that happens, but it does. We can use this concept of superposition to free computers from having binary constraints. Quantum computers use particles magnetically suspended in near absolute zero temperatures to represent not bits, but qubits. Instead of representing either one or zero, they can also represent both simultaneously. Okay, so you might be thinking, big deal. Couldn't you just achieve superposition on a classical computer by just using two ordinary bits at the same time? No need for a qubit?
No.
Because there's more to quantum physics than just superposition. There's also the idea of entanglement. If we have a system of more than one qubit, these particles are not independent of each other, they're entangled. So in a system of two qubits, the outcome of one qubit tells you what you will see when you measure the other qubits. Particles can be entangled even if they are separated in space by huge distances. Einstein called entanglement spooky action at a distance. That's my Einstein voice. What that means is that you can't just describe a system of several qubits using descriptions of individual qubits. You have to describe the correlations between qubits. And as you increase the number of them, the number of correlations grows exponentially. So for a system of just 300 qubits, you'd need more numbers than there are atoms in the visible universe to describe. Think about that for a second. So because we can't just write down the info contained in a system of a few hundred qubits using classical bits, maybe a computer running on these qubits can perform tasks that classical computers couldn't achieve. That's why people think quantum computing holds a lot of promise. So let's build a simple quantum algorithm in Python using IBM's Quantum API to learn more. You can sign up for access to their API easily on their website, then download the SDK to use it in Python. After we import it, we're going to build the Deutsch-Jose algorithm, one of the first quantum algos to be proposed. We are given a quantum computer, known as an oracle, that implements some function f. It takes n-digit binary values as input and produces either a 0 or 1 as output for each value. The function is constant, 0 on all inputs or 1 on all inputs. It could also be balanced, so it returns 1 for half of the input domain and 0 for the other half. The task is to decide if f is constant or balanced by using the oracle. First, we'll initialize a quantum program object with a quantum and classical register holding 3 bits. The program lets us manipulate quantum circuits, and each circuit has a set of data registers. We'll apply what's called a Hadamard gates to every qubit. So now all the possible states are equally likely to be observed. For every possible state, we'll apply the oracle. In our case, the oracle is a balanced function. Then we'll apply the H gate to all the qubits once more, and that's it for our algorithm. For a constant function, we can expect a 100% chance of observing all zeros, and for a balanced function, we can expect anything else. This shows that a black box problem can be solved efficiently by a quantum computer with no error, whereas a classical computer would need way more queries to the black box to solve the problem.
I've sacrificed relationships for greatness. These hands have yet to create their masterpiece. Intelligence is in my grasp.
So there are 3 takeaways here. Quantum physics is the study of physical phenomena that happen at the atomic or subatomic level. Quantum computing takes advantage of quantum physics to allow for more efficient algorithms. And qubits, not bits, are the fundamental unit of quantum computing, capable of simultaneously representing both a 1 and a 0.
The wizard of the week is Noah Liddell. The challenge was to build a Q learning bot, and Noah used Keras to train a deep Q learner in the cardpole environment until it was able to successfully balance itself. Loved the animation at the end. Great work. And the runner-up is Yi Jung Wan. He used TensorFlow to build a DQN for the game Breakout with no high-level wrappers. Nicely done.
The coding challenge for this week is to try your hand at building a simple quantum algorithm using IBM's API. Details are in the README. Post your GitHub link in the comments, and I'll announce a winner next week. I hope you liked this video. Please subscribe for more like it if you did. And for now, I've got a quantum teleport, so thanks for watching.